Hello and welcome. Welcome to our final series, our final occasion for Ideas at Ford. And we saved the best for last. I am Darren Walker. I'm lucky enough to be president of the Ford Foundation. I am a brown-skinned, bald-headed man wearing Lucite glasses. I have a blue shirt and a blue vest on here, and I'm in my office at the Ford Foundation, and I am delighted to welcome my friend, Indra Nooyi. Welcome, Indra Nooyi, the author of this amazing book called My Life in Full. My Life in Full, Work, Family, and Our Future. Welcome, Indra Nooyi, to Ideas at Ford.
Darren, thank you so much for having me. I'm Indra Nooyi. I'm a brown-skinned Asian woman. I have a full head of hair, and I'm wearing a burgundy satin silk shirt. It's great to be here, Darren. Great to chat with you.
Great to be with you. I have to say, Indra, this book is a tour de force. It is written from the perspective of an immigrant girl with big dreams coming to America and realizing those dreams beyond what even she could imagine her future would be. But it is also a story punctuated by backs, by many challenges, by heartaches, by self-doubt, by deep introspection of the choices this woman made on her journey to a life that has been full, a life where family was certainly at the center and family made it all possible for her. And yet there is so much, Indra Nooyi, in this book that leaves us reflecting not just on your journey, but on this idea of our shared future, which is at the center. But before we get to that idea of the shared future, I want you to talk about this journey. Begins in the south of India, in a place and a house that is unlike anything I certainly would have experienced on my American journey. Talk about the beginning and what it was like to have your parents and your grandparents and all of the love and support around you and community.
The love, support, discipline. Let's not forget the word discipline also.
It was deep in your household.
True. I was actually lucky to have been born when I was, where I was, to the family that I was born into, all in retrospect. To put it into context, I was born 8 years after India got independence, after 350 years of being ruled by the British. So it was a new India. You know, I was born into this new free India. And India was trying to figure out its role in the world, its role, you know, as a place for education, for women. Everything was being sorted out in the country. And when I was born, I was born into a family in the south of India, a very conservative family, with a father who was highly educated, a grandfather highly educated, but a mother who didn't go to college because her family didn't have money to send her to college, which was very, very smart. Had she gone to college and been allowed to dream, she would have been a CEO and this whole story would have been different. But, you know, having been born into this family, I always heard the men say that the women should have opportunities equal to the men. So the women and men should be allowed to dream and soar.
That was uncommon. That was uncommon.
It was uncommon in India at that time.
Yes.
But within that South Indian Brahmin community, it was not uncommon, but it wasn't terribly common. I mean, a lot of people in my peer group went to college, women in particular. And I also grew up in an environment where, you know, we had a mother with one foot on the brake and one foot on the accelerator. On the one hand, she was hearing her husband and her father-in-law, who was really the head of the household, saying, The girls have to dream, they have to soar, let them be educated, let them be whatever they want. On the other hand, she would have liked that for us too, because she would have loved to have lived life like we were going to live. But deep down inside, she was in a society where girls got married at age 18. So there she was with her sisters and her relatives trying to find horoscopes so she could match, not the American horoscope, these are detailed Indian horoscopes, matching guys so that we could get married. So this was this confusion, you know, are we going to get married or are we going to study? My father and grandfather said, don't worry, you guys are going to study, you're going to dream, you can be whatever you want. So there were three legs on the accelerator and one leg on the brake. And I think my mother constantly lived with this confusion, but ultimately we were allowed to dream, we were allowed to soar, we were pushed, we were encouraged, and we were disciplined. I mean, if we didn't listen to the older people, because the home was a big multi-generational home, if we didn't give respect to the elders, if we didn't listen to them, then it doesn't matter if it was unreasonable, you just listen to them because they were older than you. You know, you got appropriately disciplined, and I don't even want to talk about discipline. We got disciplined. And timeouts didn't help those days because we never went out. So every day was a timeout. And so I think we lived within a framework which had freedom within that frame. But don't you dare violate that frame.
And you lived in a system, as you said, a new India. I mean, India, as most of us know it, certainly we Americans, I don't believe we fully grasp what it was like to be a colonial country and to have the excitement, of course, about figuring it out, as you so beautifully describe in the book. But there was a lot of that had negative implications for Indians. The sort of arrogance of the British, what I would call the sort of white supremacist notions that were very clear and clearly delineated, a lot of Indians had to live with.
Well, fortunately, I was not born in that time. My parents lived in that time. When I was born and I came into my own, I had the benefits of the colonial remnants. For example, I was educated in a convent school run by Irish nuns who took a special interest in us. And they really spent their evenings and their weekends helping us with diction and speech and things like that. So I saw the benefits of the remnants of the colonial rule. You know, we had a bureaucracy that worked, railway system that worked, but we also had an India which worried about skin color. Because it was always believed that, you know, anything but a white skin was not very acceptable. But I didn't feel that, because in our family that was never ever brought up, and that was never an issue. So,
but you are a prominent Brahmin family.
Sure, we are. But you know, the interesting part is when people talk about Brahmin family, they think that you're born into wealth, you're born into fame, and no, Brahmins are exactly the opposite. No wealth, but a lot of education.
Yes,
and an incredible focus on making sure that everybody in the family is educated the right way, as opposed to creating wealth. It's get educated and contribute to the country, either through government service, being a doctor or a lawyer. But corporate jobs were never considered okay for Brahmins to do. It was interesting, isn't it? The word corporation was like, what is that? That's, you know, that's not serving the country or doing the good work of saving lives.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful. So this young woman goes off to college. She is a star. She does well. There you are taking science classes. So you were an early STEM star before there was such a thing as STEM. And when you came to, I love the story of the way your family rallied as it was time for you to travel. Here you are coming, you land at JFK. Just talk about what that felt like for you.
Well, Imam, let's rewind a little bit. I wish I was a star in college. I believe that I have to climb trees, play cricket, play in a rock band. Yes, I thought life was more than just academics.
You were the Stevie Nicks of India, of at least southern India.
I was convinced that My life should be about a complete balance, lots of extracurricular activities. I studied multiple languages. I mean, I was into life in full, let me put it that way. And, you know, if there was a debating competition, I was always out there doing whatever it took to be participating and winning debates. So I was one of these kids who thought academics was good, but it's not all.
You were well-rounded, really well-rounded.
Extremely well-rounded. Yeah. And there were subjects I struggled with, Darren, and this is where my parents did step in and give me tutoring help, even though, you know, society might have said, oh my God, your daughter is dumb. They said, forget it. We're going to get her a tutor to help her. So one thing led to another. Then I get admission to the Yale School of Management. And I was surprised my parents allowed me to go. I would have thought they'd have said, you know, you get married and you can go with somebody, but not alone. But for some reason, my father said, no, she's going to go. And they came to the airport and saw me.
He played such a critical role. Indra, you're the way you write about him, and of course, all the way until the end of his life, is with such deep care and passion for this man.
I was his favorite, so it helps. So he saw us off at the airport, my mother and father, both of them saw us off, and I land in JFK, and I've never been outside the country. So you land in JFK, first of all, I think JFK is like the eighth wonder of the world. A huge airport, so orderly, so clean, multiple nationalities, you know, walking through the airport in an orderly way, I'm just blown away. And then I get into this long bus-like structure called the Connecticut Limousine, and it's gliding through I-95 to New York, through New York to Connecticut. And there's no honking sounds, which India is famous for. No animals walking on the road, which India is famous for. And all the cars staying in their lanes, which I've never seen in my life. So I'm like, this must be paradise. And as we come into Connecticut, the driver goes, welcome to the best state in the country. I'm like, I'm going to study in the best state in the country. So get to Yale, and my first rude shock. There is no support structure for international students. There's an office of international students to just process your visa. But after that, you're on your own. You got to figure out where your dorm is. You got to figure out everything. And then I was lost. I was lost for a few days. I was lost for the first day, desperately lonely and lost. The second day, another international student stepped up to help me. But it took me about a week to find my footing. And those days, I tell you, it was sad, tears, lots of tears, wishing I was someplace else.
Yes, and you were wondering if you'd made a mistake and it would have been so much more comfortable back home. But one of the things that also comes out of this is the beginning of the way in which you made friendships and found mentors and who were often white men and people being attracted to you and you really connecting with people. Talk about that, because this is also a through line of your book.
Yeah, I had phenomenal mentors all my life. Mentors with the big capital M, who were my sponsors, my promoters, who stepped up and, you know, gave me tough love and gave me a helping hand when I needed it. They were all white men, and I benefited hugely from everything they did for me. They gave me the toughest assignments, but they helped me, accomplish my goals. They gave me feedback about how to act, how to give feedback, how to react to situations when they felt that I wasn't quite culturally appropriate in the way I was giving feedback.
Yeah, because in your culture, you talk about how in the book, it wasn't because your parents were at every moment saying to you, good job, Indra, good job, way to go.
That word didn't exist in their vocabulary. I was thinking the other day, what would my parents have been upset about? If my kid brother got a 98 in mathematics, they would say, oh, you brought shame to the family. So it was a whole different mindset and an approach. I don't think they've ever hugged us or said, I love you. The word I love you, they would have thought was mushy. Never, ever. But the point is, you couldn't go complain to anybody else because nobody else had parents who gave them a hug and said, I love you. So that was how society was. So love was assumed. The other thing too is I grew up in an environment where If you put on a play for the parents and the uncles, halfway through the play, they just get up and leave and go, "Why are you leaving?" "Well, not very good. Do better next time." They just walk out. And so all of us cousins, like, we just finished the play anyway because we've already prepared for it, but there'd be nobody in the audience. So that's the environment we grew up under, you know, strong criticism, no compliments, develop a backbone. You got to be confident on your own. So I've had phenomenal mentors who've lifted me every step of the way. And Darren, I'll be honest with you, I don't think I'd be here today but for them. And I'm talking of people at work and people outside of work too. People would come out of the woodwork and say, "I'm going to give you a helping hand." You know, people on the board, people like you. I mean, I'll give you, you know, the Batkins, Alan Batkin. I mean, he used to work for Kissinger Associates, the way he would step up and provide help. John Straczynski, all people that you know. I mean, John
but
was
you, but
offered
Indra,
help.
You attract people who want to make sure you are successful. That's one of your many gifts. And you talk about some of the ways in which when you left Yale School of Management, where you started as an international student who didn't know your way around the campus. And of course, now I love the fact that the deanship of the Yale School of Management is endowed, and it is now the Indra Nooyi Dean. And yeah, so I enjoy getting messages from the Indra Nooyi Dean, Kerwin, at the Yale School of Management. But one of the things that is so poignant and is the vignette where you are interviewing and very competitive because you had decided on management consulting. Management consulting was the most prestigious and the most difficult job internships to secure. And you turn up for your interview and you realize that you were not dressed like the women who were also interviewing. And you clearly felt somewhat ashamed, or if you made a big mistake, and there's no way you would land this prestigious internship with BCG. Mm. Talk about that, because the end of the story, of course, is that you end up being a star at BCG, but talk about the beginning.
You know, you had to get a summer job because scholarships don't work in the summer, because all of our scholarships are tied to working in the college. And so there were no jobs in the summer. So you have to find a job somewhere to get ready for the second year and to make ends meet. So the first interview I had was with a company called Insilco from Connecticut. And nobody told me how I should dress because there was no support structure. And I'd never worn anything that showed my legs before. So I realized I'm not going to wear a skirt. I'll go buy a pantsuit. And I only had $50. So I wandered over to Kresge's, which is on Chapel Street in New Haven.
Well, we would know it. Kmart.
Kmart, yeah. Now. And I bought myself a blue polyester pantsuit. But I was too shy to try on because the fitting room had a drape and I was afraid somebody would see me because I'd never been in a fitting room before. So, you know, everything we take for granted, I hadn't been through. So I bring it home and I didn't have the presence of mind to try it on the previous night. So the morning of the interview, I put the clothes on. The jacket's two sizes too big, hangs on me. My trousers, you know, comes to my ankle, and I look like a freak job. And I'm sitting here going, what am I going to do now? I can't wear my, you know, jeans and t-shirt to the interview. So I'm just going to show up like this. With bravado, I walk up to the interview place. And when I walk into the room where all the people are waiting for their turns, they all start to snicker and laugh. And I realize I'm in trouble, but I have no choice. So I walk into the interview. I tuck my legs under the table because they were horrible shoes, snow shoes. And the interview goes on. And at the end of it, I run to the development office and she says, you look like a freak job. And I said, what am I supposed to do? I've spent all my money on these clothes. I have nothing left. You know, we now have Rent the Runway and Real where you can buy used clothes. Those days, Salvation Army or Kresge's. Those were my only two choices, okay? And so she said, well, what would you wear in India? I said, I'd wear a sari. She said, okay, your next interview, wear a sari. And if they won't have you for who you are, it's their loss. Don't let your clothes define you. So for my next interview with Booz Allen, who was my summer job company, I wore a sari, and a partner from Texas interviewed me and gave me the job. But even more telling, Darren, InSilco also gave me an offer for the summer, which sort of blew me away, because I said, huh, they offered this total odd-looking person a summer job based on the strength of what I said in the interview. I must have done okay. So I wasn't used to being assessed only on merit. And that was an eye-opener for me, I'll be honest with you, both InSilco and Booz Allen.
And because talent really prevailed. And that, again, is a part of your story, because you then, you were at Booz Allen, but you ultimately went to BCG.
Yep. My final job was at BCG, right?
And you, after Yale, and you did spectacularly, but you also met your amazing Raj. That's a little part of this story too, because there would be no Indra without Raj, which you make really clear, because he was such a critical part. And the thing that I do love about your book, Indra, is you really say, just as you just said about the white men who, I wouldn't be here. This the Indra story wouldn't be written.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously Raj is at the center of the Indra story, but particularly the way you narrate Raj's unwavering support for you mm-hmm. and your career. So much mm-hmm. so that when you had the opportunity to come back east, he, without a real clear sense of what he would do, even though he had a master's degree and he had a great career mm-hmm. prospect, he came back east with you.
Yeah. I mean, look, I married well. I married the right guy. And I chanced upon him in Chicago. He was a friend of a friend, and something clicked. And 42 years later, we're still arguing about who proposed to whom. But irrespective of that, we've endured. And the commitment to each other is complete. Hasn't always been a cakewalk. As with all marriages, you go through highs and lows.
Yeah.
Challenges. Yeah. How do you work your way through this? Okay. Once a commitment is there, you figure out how to work your way through it. And he has been my support every step of the way. No question about it.
And you make that really, really clear. And it's beautiful the way you do. And you also make clear when you become an American, I mean, your love of this country, your just deep commitment to this country, which doesn't mean that you're blind to the things that are wrong, but that you clearly believe in this country and believe in the potential for the goodness of people in this country.
Mm.
And there's a part in the book when you are in your CEO days, and you, I believe, are with a group of CEOs and ministers and heads of state, and I believe it was the British prime minister asks you, and they say, oh, and Indra has come, and she's been amazing, and head of PepsiCo, and he says something like, why did you immigrate to America and not come to the UK? And your response was, because you said something like, I wouldn't be CEO if I were.
I was at lunch at Checkers in the UK. And
yeah.
He said, 30 years ago, when you went to the US, why didn't you come to the UK? And I said, because, Mr. Prime Minister, I wouldn't be here having lunch with you had I, you know, come to the United Kingdom as opposed to having gone to America. So I think that I am a story of how immigrants can come here, work hard, contribute, and be a success. The system allows you to dream and gives you a chance.
Absolutely. I want to get to the point in which is a profound moment in this book. You know, your trajectory at PepsiCo was pretty remarkable. Most of the people who, well, all of the men who succeeded you, preceded you, had run big operating units of the company. You had a management consulting background. You had in other companies ran big operations, but within PepsiCo, you had really been on the sort of strategy. And then, of course, you were CFO, and you moved into, and on that journey, you were incredibly patient and gracious, I would say, because you were not afforded, while yes, you had lots of support in your family, but there were lots of things. It was a clubby boys culture. The golfing, the outings that the men took, your peers in the C-suite, you were not afforded, or not afforded, you were not invited. And yet you persevered. And clearly you impressed them. But talk about how, as a woman, sitting in the C-suite with these guys, mm-hmm. and they're running off to the Bahamas. You have these vignettes where you are literally putting the PowerPoint deck together for the board meeting. And they've gone off to the Bahamas. How did, talk about that.
Well, you know, golfing, fishing, skeet shooting, hunting, riding, horseback riding was all part of the club those days. That's what people did on weekends. Senior executives.
Well, that's what men did on weekends.
Well, remember, that's what senior executives did, but they were all men those days. Okay, that's what they did. They had wonderful stay-at-home wives, and they did that. In my case, first of all, I don't fish, I don't hunt, I don't ride, I don't drink. So had I gone with them, I would have been such a killjoy. So I'm glad I didn't go. But more importantly, I had a husband and kids at home. You know, in the early days, one, then two daughters. And had they invited me, I wouldn't have gone, Darren, because there's no way in hell I'm going to give up my weekends to be with colleagues at work doing things that are all fun while I've got kids and a husband at home. So I was never invited. And even had I been invited, I wouldn't have gone. So personally, I didn't care. My only concern was, are they going to make decisions in these retreats and then come back and present it to me and say, we decided this. And this is where I think the mentors came into play, because somebody like a Roger Enrico, who would lead these retreats, basically would tell the guys in the retreat, we will make no decisions at this retreat. We will discuss no business, because we're not going to make a decision and not have Indra be part of the decision making, because she will let me know exactly what she thinks. So we're not going to do that. So when they came back, there were no decisions made. There was no business that was discussed. They really had fun. I'm glad they did. Because when there was a decision to be made, I was always at the table.
And ultimately, the board, when the time came, made the decision to appoint you first president of PepsiCo. And I want you to take us back to the moment, because it is a profound moment in this beautiful autobiography. The moment, which is what I call the leave your crown in the garage moment. Talk about, you are made president. You are jubilant. So much of what you have worked for in your career has come to pass on this day. And you say one of the reasons you decided even to interview for PepsiCo was because it was close to Greenwich, and you and the girls and your husband, it was easier for you.
Yeah.
So it wasn't like you sought out PepsiCo, but PepsiCo was a good convenient, but you prevail as president. And you're driving home, so excited to tell your mom, who lived with you, Raj, and the girls, this great news. And you park your car and you walk into your beautiful home in Greenwich. There is your mother. And well, you are to tell her the great news.
And she said, I don't want to hear any news. Just go get me some milk. And I'm like, why didn't you get Raj to get the milk? I wish he had gotten the milk. There would have been no story. But she said he looked tired, so I didn't ask him. So you go get it. Now it's not 10 in the night. So I did get the milk and I came back and I was really upset with her because I thought she should have allowed me to have my moment of glory. And instead she said, look, I don't care if you become president or on the board, whatever it is you said you got, you know, you just got appointed to. When you walk into this house, you're the wife, the mother, the daughter, and the daughter-in-law. So just leave your crown in the garage. So at that point, I was miffed because I thought she should have allowed me to celebrate my brief moment of joy. But her point was, hey, when you come home, we don't work for you. People here don't work for you. You have a very different role. So put on that humility hat and come in and say, what can I do in the service of this family? But I don't think the message is just for me, Darren. I think that message applies to Raj too. So both of us have reflected on that and realized that for us, it's both of us being equal members of the home and leaving any vestiges of power in the garage, and just walking in with humility and saying, we are responsible for this family. So while I'm still upset with my mother because the story lingers, on the other hand, I think she grounded us and our kids, even though occasionally they do say, we don't work for you, mom, stop ordering us around. I would say 90% of the time, they don't say that. So that's a good thing.
Well, your girls are about as close to perfect as you can get. And so
Darren, if only. No,
that's you and Raj. But I do have to, for a moment, say your patience. I mean, it wasn't, yes, grounding you in humility, but also you deserve to be celebrated in that moment. I mean, Indra, you're the first woman to head a Fortune 50 company. Your story, there had been no immigrant woman, no woman. I mean, and so.
Remember the background of the family. They don't compliment, they don't say love you, they don't say good job. They only know how to criticize you. So that's the background. So it's okay if they don't compliment you. It's all right. Because, you know, even now, if you ask my mother, are you proud of your daughter? She'll say, well, what does she do? I pray 4 hours a day for her. That's why she gets all these accolades. But you know what, Darren? It's okay. That's just fine. Let her say whatever she wants to. I'm sure deep down inside, she's proud.
Oh,
it's culturally not okay to come out and say that. So,
of course it is. But when you told that story, as you remember, I was in the auditorium at the Aspen Ideas Festival.
Yeah.
And an audible gasp in the room. And then, of course, you went on to challenge Anne-Marie Slaughter, or maybe it was...
David Bradley,
exactly. About and this notion that, well, women can have it all. You just have to lean in and work hard and you can have it all. And you, of course, are like, I'm not sure I agree with that.
Yeah, it's true. I think we juggle everything. You know, in the past, we had multiple priorities, being a wife, mother, you know, a homemaker, and then on top of that, being an executive was just juggling so many priorities. Remember, we didn't have all these technologies we now have. I think the good news, Darren, is coming from those days where I was rising as an executive, then became CEO today, post-COVID, with technologies, with the advancements in smartphones and all the ways we have to communicate with our kids, we can move from juggling work and family to really balancing work and family. I think it's doable. With a little bit of help and support, you can do it. In those days, there was no way to, I mean, you had to travel. You couldn't talk to your international employees on Zoom. You had to get out there and meet all of them. So it was constant travel, constant meetings, being at work all the time. Flexibility, that is not a word that we knew existed in the lexicon.
Well, you talk about that, and this is where our future. This is where you come in and you, because among the things I love about this book is you talk about how privileged you were to have your mother, and you'd have relatives from India come and stay for a while with the girls. You'd have ways of triaging to make sure you were able to pay for a housekeeper. I mean, you talk about, but what about women who don't have my privilege?
Mm-hmm.
What about women who are in the care economy? You spend a lot of time talking about mm-hmm. the infrastructure for care in this country for workers and particularly for women workers. Talk about that and your view on this care economy.
Look, people like me, once we reach managerial positions, we can afford to pay for care. The real question is finding it. Okay, once you find it, you can pay for it, whether it's single care, caregivers for your kids, or putting them in a wonderful daycare center. I think when I co-chaired Reopen Connecticut, my eyes were opened to the plight of essential workers, the caregivers themselves, the people who work in seniors care homes, who work in childcare homes, who work in hospitals as nurses, a lot of the cleaning staff. You know, during the pandemic, they had to come to work every day. They didn't have the option to work flexibly. It required that human interaction. And on top of that, when we asked them to come to work in a hospital or a senior center, we also asked them to stay there for 2 weeks or 3 weeks at a time, because for quarantine reasons, they couldn't go back and forth. But we never did anything extraordinary to provide childcare for them or care for the aging parents. And so if you put yourself in their shoes, what were they supposed to do? How were they supposed to take care of their children? The little childcare that was available, the rates were through the roof. These people weren't getting extra pay. So I think that problem has lingered, Darren. And I come back and I say, we should talk about providing the office-going women the ability to raise a family and keep a job. Very important. But I think supporting the essential worker, the hourly worker who has to go to a job and not have flexibility, supporting them with the care infrastructure has reached critical proportions. That's why we have the great resignation, where 2.8 million people have left the workforce, of which almost 2 million are women who say, I don't have caregiving facilities for my aging parents or my kids. And I think we have to look at this as a societal crisis, because we have 10,000 people turning 65 every day, the boomer generation, and many of them are going to need care going forward. So we need people to be in the caregiving job, but we need to care for the caregiver. Somehow we don't pay them right, we don't treat them right, and then we wonder why they're leaving the job. So I think it's time we had serious conversation about this, a serious conversation.
I can see we have questions, and I want, because we've only got 15 minutes here, 20 minutes. Elizabeth, please, we are eager to hear from the audience and to allow Indra to respond.
Thank you, Darren, and thank you, Indra. I'd love to start with a question about folks advocating for you, Indra, which is the men in your family during your time in school and the mentors in your professional life were huge advocates for you. So why should men get off the sidelines and start advocating for women in general, especially since the existing structure is quite comfortable and generally more lucrative for them?
I think all men should look at this issue we're talking about as a issue of the future of the country, the growth of the country. Think like an economist. Don't say this is a feminist issue, because at the end of the day, the country is going to succeed if all of the available talent works to improve the country, works to increase the GDP of the country. Women are 50% of the population, 70% of the high school valedictorians. They're getting more than 50% of the college degrees. They're getting the top grades. They're more than 50% of the professional degrees. They are 47% of MIT's graduating class. When you've got such a fantastic talent base, what are we saying? That we don't want to deploy this talent base in the service of the economy? Something's wrong with us. I think we ought to be thinking about drawing from the entire workforce as opposed to just a portion of the workforce. And I think that once we decide to draw from the entire workforce, because that's the right thing to do for the sake of the country and the growth of the country, we also want to have families. We also want children. So we have to find a way to support these women to be able to contribute to the economy and to be family builders. And the only way we're going to put the right programs in place is if the men in power come to the table to have these conversations. And I'm going to make this personal. If any man has a daughter or a sister or a niece or a wife in the workforce, you want them to be treated right. You want them to be supported. Why not adopt that same stance at work and say, I want to support women at work. I want to help provide a support structure for women at work. Because at the end of the day, having children is the right thing for the country. Deploying all the women in the service of the country is the right thing. If you don't want to work, that's a different issue. But those who want to work, it's the right thing to do. And finally, families are messy. Families are fragile. I think it's critically important women have economic freedom and freedom of the purse. I strongly believe that women should have economic freedom.
Thank you so much, Indra. As the next question, a little more general, it's how can we ensure that companies care about their employees' work-life balance? Is there a way to incentivize companies to do this? What's in it for them?
You know, come back. Right now, retention of employees is the single biggest issue. Retention of talent. Let's not call them employees, talent. Because we should look at employees as assets, not as tools of the trade. If you look at them as assets, retaining them is the most important thing. And we've got to worry about the stresses and strains this talent goes through once they leave the office. And so if we want them to contribute their best to work, we've got to make sure that we make their life a bit easier as opposed to more stressful because we demand too much from them at work. I'm going to go so far and say, all this time, all discussions about family have been fringe in this future of work discussions. We really have not included that. We talk about robots, we talk about cryptocurrency, we talk about Zoom technologies advancing a lot more, et cetera, et cetera. All that's good. But I think we have to start thinking about putting family at the center of discussions on future of work. What if we said at 3:30 in the afternoon, all families can go home and get their kids off the school bus, if you have kids. And after you spend some time with your kids, you can then start to go back and work again using remote technologies if you need to. What if trading floors closed early at 3 o'clock so that people can actually go home and we can rebuild that family structure as opposed to people coming back from work at 7, 8 in the night, totally exhausted and don't even have time to interact with the families or worse still, put off having families at all. Again, these are all choices, but I'm saying, if as a country we want to rebuild the family structure, if we want kids, let's take the stress out of that. People are putting off having kids longer and longer, Darren, because they can't take the stress. People are saying, why have kids at all? Why give up my entire lifestyle? It's a lifelong commitment. Why not we provide some support? Many, many countries do it. Why can't we do it?
Amazing. In the line of family, there's a question about how you raised your daughters, if you did so in a similar way to your own upbringing, love is assumed, strong criticism, or if you did something different.
With my first daughter, a bit confused because we only knew one model, which is the way we were brought up. And we started that way, paid the price a bit, and slowly started to adjust ourselves. Our second daughter benefited from all the learnings from our first daughter. I'll be honest with you. And so we overdo the I love you and hugging because it actually feels good to hug them constantly and to tell them I love you. And my mother, who's still around, will do that and say I love you to my children. They'll never say to us kids, her own kids. I don't know what it is about that generation. They think that it's too soppy to tell their kids that they love us. But that's okay. We assume the love. But as I said, it's all a trial and error. With my first daughter, I learned it a little bit later than I did with my second.
Indra, you're often, very often, put on ranked lists of the world's most powerful women. What does that mean to you and what responsibilities does that come with?
I was very aware that those lists were positional, not personal. I was on that list only because I was a woman CEO, not because I was just a good woman. So I had to earn my place on that list every time because the expectation was if you're on the list, you'll do women proud and people look at you and say, yes, women can be in that list and they can hold on to their jobs and show that women can ascend to these positions and run successful companies. So for me, every time I was on that list, the fear factor went up. Oh God, will I keep doing well? Will the company keep doing well? Am I going to create value? So my thinking was very different. It wasn't, you know, I'm on the list. I must be a big shot. It was a little bit extra fear, a little bit more butterflies in the stomach. Because, you know, when you're so much in the public eye and so visible, the risk of falling off that perch is much more than the risk of staying on the perch. Because so many people are gunning for you to fall off. So staying on that perch is very, very difficult. And believe me, I had the immigrant fear to start with. Add to that this fear of not doing right by other women. I was always a bit nervous.
So for the next question, you have been talking about and involved in gender parity and equality for a long time. Has enough groundwork been laid now that we can make meaningful advancement in a more permanent way? What's the next step? What else needs to happen to make real societal change?
You know, we are making progress. We're not moving backwards. We're moving forwards, but at a slower pace than I would have expected. So let me give a nod to my predecessor, Steve Reinemann. He did something which I learned a lot from. He said, look, if you want to get to diversity in the workplace, if you want to get to a gender balance that reflects the employee base out there, the step one you've got to do is to get the numbers in. And once you get the numbers in, then you practice inclusive behavior on those numbers. But if you just say, we've got to have diversity and inclusion, how do you teach inclusion when you don't have enough diverse people? He had a point. So step one, he put a scorecard in which said, parity hiring, parity promotions, parity retention. For 5 years, we had that scorecard. You're going to hire 6 people, 3 are going to be diverse. Go find them because they exist. You haven't looked hard enough. So once we got a critical mass of numbers of women and diverse people in the company, then he put in place a whole series of inclusion programs so that people can learn how to deal with diversity because it was new to all of the people there. But I think that approach is very sensible because he put an inclusion on a base of numbers. So people could be called out for bad behavior and people could model the right behavior, which then the rest of the company could follow and in turn bring in more diverse talent. Not for the sake of diversity per se, but for the sake of getting the best talent from the entire employee base. So I think, you know, as I've often said, diversity is a numbers program, inclusion is a mindset. Without the numbers, you can't practice the mindset. Without the mindset, the numbers won't stick. So it's a virtuous or a doom loop, depending on how you want to interpret it.
Last question.
Wonderful. So I'm going to close out with a question about what's next for you. What are you working on right now that you're excited about?
Well, you know, the book itself was sort of a labor of love. It took a long time to write and it's done, but we still have to get the message on the road. But a couple of things. I think the most important thing is, you know, when I was at PepsiCo, we had an approach to doing business, which was called performance with purpose. How do you make money in a new way where you do things right by society? You can't lead a life of performance with purpose and then leave it once you leave PepsiCo. So the big question is, what am I doing in my life outside of PepsiCo that's still purpose-driven? And this book is a form of a blueprint for that. So I've been working now to figure out how can we build a care infrastructure that is available, affordable, and of high quality. What does it take to build that out? Clearly, you can't do it countrywide. How can you prototype it in some states and then use that example to talk about it in other states and get the message out that having a support structure for young family builders could well be a massive competitive advantage for states as they attract talent to their states, attract business to their states. So, you know, it's a moonshot. We're going to go off and work on it. A lot of people have already been working on this. So I too have thrown my hat in the ring and we're going to see how we can move this agenda forward.
Well, Indra, as is often the case, when you throw your hat in the ring, it tilts the ring, or at least the side of the ring that your hat is on towards success. So your being there, your serving with your dear friend, Governor Lamont, to in Connecticut and then nationally to really at these issues and implement both corporate policy change and government policy change, because both of those things will be necessary, as you lay out in the book, in order for us to have the real kind of care economy that allows all talent to flourish and the economy and companies and families to all benefit. So Indra, this has benefited all of us who have listened to your wise words of wisdom and your sage advice to us. As you reflect on your journey, this book is fantastic. I love that only you would be friends with Anna Wintour and be able to arrange an Annie Leibovitz photo cover, which is pretty, a beautiful, beautiful cover. And you should be proud. I hope you're proud, Indra, of My Life in Full. It is indeed a gift. And it is a gift. If you are looking for a gift for a friend for the holiday season, go out and order it. The recipient I know will be grateful. It's a great gift. So Indra, thank you. And sending you and Raj and the girls best wishes for a wonderful holiday season.
Thank you, Dan. Thank you for having me.
And we will open Ideas at Ford in January with Emily Ladau, Demystifying Disability. Emily's story and her words of wisdom as we become, as we talk about inclusion, reminding ourselves that diversity includes disability. And it is another, I think, important contribution as we work towards a more inclusive society. So thank you to everyone. Have a great holiday season, and we look forward to seeing you in January in the new year. Good day.